The PS5 may be a little older than a year now, but if you think back to when the PS5 M.2 expansion slot was officially unlocked back in mid-September, the reality is that the PCI NVMe SSD solution is still very much green, less than 4 months old to be exact. And while more manufacturers are gradually stepping into the space with their own SSD options, for the time being, it's still primarily a handful of major players in the space that PS5 owners are turning to for their internal storage solution. For this video, we're going to be taking a look at three PS5 compatible M.2 SSDs, the Seagate Firecuda 530, which is one of the most sought after SSDs on the market due to blazing speeds that can reach a max read of 7300 megabytes per second and 6900 write, the Aorus 7000, which can reach a max read of 7000 read and 5000 write, and the Aorus 5000, which is actually marginally below Sony's listed requirements, with max reads of 5000 and 45000 write megabytes per second. So we have a fairly well-rounded sample size to work with. I'll be running a series of tests for a handful of PS5 titles to gauge how each of the SSDs stacks up to one another, as well as the onboard PS5 SSD. We'll test data transfer speeds from both onboard SSD to M.2 and vice versa. We'll take a look at some in-game loading times and fast travel, and we'll even take a look at some side-by-side gameplay footage to see if we can spot any discrepancies or dips in performance. To kick things off, let's take a look at the top-line specifications for the Aorus 5000, Aorus 7000, and Firecuda 530, respectively. The Aorus 5000 has an interface of PCI Express 4x4 NVMe 1.3 and is the oldest model of the three and therefore has the slowest sequential read and write speed projections. This particular drive has a capacity of 2 TB, and as with all three of these SSDs, the Aorus 5000 ships with a pre-installed heatsink. But for this model specifically, the heatsink is fully comprised of a very dense copper material for both the top and casing as well as the base plate. Dimensions are as follows, and it's estimated to have a TBW, or total terabytes written, of 3600 TB. Now, this spec is an estimation of how many terabytes can be written onto a particular drive before it is likely to fail. So this is a good spec to be mindful of when you're shopping for SSDs. Other means of measuring an SSD's durability include specs such as MTBF or DWPD. If you want to get even deeper into the weeds when you're shopping for a particular drive, you can generally obtain these more granular details by pulling a data sheet for a given SSD that you're considering. Moving along to the Aorus 7000, which has an interface of PCI Express 4x4 NVMe 1.4. This particular drive has a capacity of 1 TB, and the top portion of the heatsink consists of a nano-carbon coating to better distribute heat, while the base plate is comprised of aluminum. Dimensions are identical to the Aorus 5000, which do fit within Sony requirements, and it has a total terabytes written of 700 TB. And lastly, the Firecuda 530 with heatsink, which too has an interface of PCI Express 4x4 NVMe 1.4. The body is comprised of aluminum and has an anodized finish to better assist with cooling efficiency. Dimensions are as follows, and you can see that the build is noticeably slimmer than with the Aorus drives. It has a TW of 2550 TB, and one other standout with Seagate's Firecuda is that it does come with a 3-year rescue data recovery service. Once you have a drive that fits within Sony's specifications and requirements, the installation process for an M.2 SSD with a pre-installed heatsink is very straightforward, which is a perk of going the pre-installed route, in addition to peace of mind that your heatsink is specifically engineered and optimized for the SSD that it encases. I don't know if it's just me, but I always get a little tense when the time comes to remove the stock plates, because I've already gotten a few light scuffs here and there from swapping out decals. But a pro tip is to control the movement of the plate with your offhand once it's unhinged. Before you begin the install, make sure to touch a metal object to remove static electricity. I'm using a #1 Phillips screwdriver to remove the first screw securing the M.2 cover. Make sure that that shiny round spacer is seated within the hole labeled H0 upon removal of the second mini screw. This one's really, really easy to drop inside the fan, so move very slowly and deliberately to place it off to the side for safekeeping. Once the SSD is seated into the terminal at a diagonal position, lower the back portion of the SSD so you can fasten it down securely using that micro screw that is absolutely begging to get lost inside the console. If you've got butterfingers, you may want to consider covering the fan with a few strips of painter's tape before you begin. Once the M.2 is secure, reattach the cover using the original screw. Snap the side plate back into place, and then it's time to head back over to your TV. In the interest of time, I'm not going to show this process for each SSD, being that they each have pre-installed heatsinks and dimensions are virtually identical. And though I showed the install for the Firecuda 530, we're going to kick things off with the Aorus 5000 from this point. Upon powering on the PS5 after install, you'll be asked to format the SSD, at which time the PS5 will provide you with a rough estimate of sequential read speed. As you can see, for the Oris 5000, the read estimate is showing roughly 3,863 megabytes per second, which is definitely below Sony's 5500 requirement, as well as Gigabyte's advertised 5,000 megabytes per second. But from my experience across the board, the PS5 has a tendency to underestimate this value. Fast forward to the Oris 7000 installed, sequential read speed is showing roughly 6,556 megabytes per second versus the 7,000 advertised, and the Fire CUDA 530 is showing roughly 6,557 megabytes per second versus the 73,000 advertised. For the head-to-head showdown, we'll kick things off with transferring games from onboard to the respective M.2 SSDs using the following titles: Spider-Man Miles Morales, Kena Bridge of Spirits, and finally Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart. Imagine that, the Oris 5000, the SSD with the lowest sequential read speed of 3800 megabytes per second, according to PS5, came out on top 2 out of the 3 test runs, and the Fire CUDA 530, which had the highest estimated read speed of 6557 megabytes per second, came in dead last on all 3 test runs. I ran these tests multiple times to ensure that any variations in the numbers weren't skewing the results, but this was the case each and every time. The Oris 5000 came out on top for Spider-Man Miles Morales and Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, regardless. But I would have never guessed this. What was your prediction? Let me know down in the comments below. Moving on to the data transfer test from the M.2 SSD back to the main onboard. Right off the bat, it's immediately apparent transferring games from onboard internal SSD to the M.2 is significantly faster than transferring from M.2 back to the onboard. Sony's custom SSD appears to take full advantage of the hyper write speeds that it's capable of, but when it comes to read, nothing could be further from the truth. And this is obviously not 100% reflective of the third-party SSDs themselves. Sony's stock SSD reads couldn't possibly be this slow. There's definitely something at play behind the scenes that the average consumer is not privy to. Nevertheless, the Fire CUDA 530 really came to the forefront for this test run. Faster transfer speeds for Spider-Man, Kena, and Ratchet, and it would appear that the Oris 5000, being the slowest of the three, finally came back down to earth. For this next run, we'll be taking a look at some in-game loading times as well as fast travel. I'll let each of these run and then we'll discuss after. Thank you. Surprisingly, the Auris 5000 came up big once again, snagging the W for 2 out of 4 test runs, excluding the onboard SSD. We had a 4-way tie for Kenner Bridge of Spirits, and the Firecuda didn't come out on top for any of the runs, as I anticipated. Also, the onboard SSD even came in dead last for one of the Spider-Man load tests. Next up, gameplay. Kicking things off first with Spider-Man Miles Morales. Gameplay across the Firecuda 530, the Auris 7000, and the Auris 5000 was relatively consistent across the board in comparison to Sony's custom onboard SSD. I didn't notice any major stuttering or frame drops, even for the Auris 5000, and if I removed all of the drive labels and rearranged the clips, my hunch is that you'd be hard-pressed to differentiate one from the other. But after extensive gameplay for this title across all SSDs, I'd say the performance hierarchy was as follows. Onboard, Firecuda 530, Auris 7000, and finally, Auris 5000. Kenner Bridge of Spirits was another where performance from drive to drive was virtually indistinguishable. And fast travel test results, again, were identical from onboard all the way down to the Auris 5000. If I had to pick a winner though, I'd say the onboard seems to handle the game a tad bit better than all the others. Overall, I put the performance rating for Kenner Bridge of Spirits as follows. Onboard, Auris 7000, Firecuda 530, and finally Auris 5000. This Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart sequence is probably the best of the three, because it's definitely the most demanding from a bandwidth standpoint. Ratchet passes through more than 7 independent portals throughout this short sequence within less than 60 seconds. The interesting finding here is that there actually appears to be some frame loss across all drives, including the onboard, but it appears to be most apparent, surprisingly, with the Firecuda 530. When freezing a number of frames at the identical spot within the sequence, Ratchet himself, along with images in the backdrop, just don't appear to be as sharp as with the others. I'd say from best to worst, it would have to be onboard, Auris 7000, Auris 5000, and finally the Firecuda 530. So when it's all said and done, how did the Firecuda 530, the Auris 7000, and the Auris 5000 NVMe drives stack up to one another? To simplify things, I removed the onboard custom SSD from the equation, because this is obviously engineered into the PS5 console, so you have no choice in the matter. However, for the third-party SSDs, for each test run, I used a 3-star rating system. The winner for each test run received 3 stars, while second place received 2, and third place a single star. And in rarer cases where there were draws, I distributed the ratings equally. Tallying up the comprehensive ratings, I came to the following results. Auris 7000, 29 stars, the Firecuda 530, 27 stars, and the Auris 5000, 26 stars. I want to emphasize that this is obviously a small sample size, and considering some small variances here and there, this isn't a definitive open shut case, but I think that it provides some great insight nonetheless, with regard to compatibility and performance for real-world use case scenarios. In most cases, all we have to go off of is specifications and certifications, so it's cool to be able to garner some key takeaways in a non-controlled environment. Now, the Auris 7000 came out slightly on top as the overall winner because it was the most well-balanced of the three SSDs, offering relatively steady performance for both read and write across the majority of the test. The Auris 7000 PS5 sequential read speeds were only a hair behind the Firecuda 530, but it flat-out outperformed it for each and every test run for onboard to M.2. The Firecuda 530 had a very slow start with transferring games from onboard to M.2. It came in last place behind the Auris 7000 and the Auris 5000 for each test run, but for points lost, it quickly made up when it came to transferring games from M.2 back to the onboard. I will say that I was a bit perplexed by recorded gameplay performance, however, specifically for Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, as the Aorus 7000 and the Aorus 5000 appear to handle this sequence a lot better. But it's worth noting that I haven't played through the entire course of the game across all three SSDs. But overall, it was the slower test results from transferring games from onboard to M.2 that ultimately prevented the Firecuda from inching ahead for the number one slot. The Aorus 5000 was 100% the dark horse for this entire exercise, and based on the PS5 sequential read speed of 3,863 megabytes per second, it didn't seem to belong in the discussion from the very jump. But miraculously enough, the Aorus 5000 was barely inched out by the Firecuda 530. It won two out of the three onboard to M.2 test runs, and it performed surprisingly well for loading and fast travel exercises. So at the end of the day, I think it's safe to say that 3,800 megabytes per second estimated from the PS5 is far below reality. However, as developers begin to push the boundaries further for future games with more rigorous bandwidth demands, it still remains to be seen how the Aorus 5000 will stand to the test of time. But all in all, I was impressed by how well it held its own against two SSD juggernauts. Before I wrap this one up, I'm curious to know what SSD you favored throughout this entire exercise. And if you own a PS5, do you also have an M.2 installed for additional storage? And if so, what brand or capacity are you currently using? If you have yet to take advantage of the M.2 expansion slot option, do you plan on picking one up in the near future? And if so, what SSD specifically do you have your eye on? And last but not least, what PS5 games are you guys currently playing? I'm currently playing Demon's Souls, Guardians of the Galaxy, and I'm still working on Kena: Bridge of Spirits, Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, and I'm finally wrapping up Ghost of Tsushima. There just aren't enough hours in the day anymore. As always, thanks for watching and supporting the channel, and I will see you guys in the next one. Peace.